Welcome back to those who joined our previous webcast during the consultation stage, and welcome to new viewers. Today we will be walking you through the IASB's recently published targeted amendments to IFRS 9 and IFRS 7 relating to contracts referencing nature-dependent electricity. I'm Dennis Daisel, a member of the technical staff at the IASB, and joining me again is my colleague Matthias Schuler. Matthias, since our last webcast, we've moved from proposals to final amendments. Could you outline what we'll be covering today?
Thank you, Dennis, and a warm welcome to our viewers. We want to give our viewers an overview over the amendments issued on the 18th of December 2024, and B, with that background in mind, discuss the main aspects of the changes to IFRS 9 and IFRS 7 as listed on this slide. Dennis, given the significant interest we received during the consultation period, we will go into the background and objectives of these amendments.
No, thanks, Matthias. So these amendments are the result of a referral made by the IFRS Interpretations Committee following a question about the application of the own use exception in paragraph 2.4 of IFRS 9, IFRS 9 being our accounting standard on financial instruments. The question related to contracts to buy and take delivery of electricity produced from nature-dependent sources. Now, the objective of these amendments is to enable companies to better report the financial effects of nature-dependent electricity contracts. Often these are structured what we call power purchase agreements, or in short, PPAs. Now, the IASB acted swiftly in the light of the increased use of these contracts.
Thanks, Dennis. So nature-dependent electricity contracts help companies to secure their electricity supply from sources such as wind and solar power. The amount of electricity generated under these contracts can vary based on uncontrollable factors such as weather conditions. Current accounting requirements may not adequately capture how these contracts affect a company's performance.
That's so true. So to allow companies to better reflect these contracts in their financial statements, the IASB has made targeted amendments to IFRS 9, financial instruments, and IFRS 7, financial instruments disclosures. Now, these amendments include mainly three things. Firstly, clarifying the application of the own use requirements. Secondly, permitting hedge accounting if these contracts are used as hedging instruments. And lastly, adding new disclosure requirements to enable investors to understand the effect of these contracts on a company's financial performance and cash flows.
The amendments are required to be applied for annual reporting periods beginning on or after the 1st of January 2026. However, the amendments can be applied earlier, and the date of initial application is not limited to the beginning of an annual reporting period, which means companies can apply the amendments earlier from the beginning of any reporting period starting before the 1st of January 2026.
Now, from the background to this project, our viewers may then appreciate that contracts for or referencing nature-dependent electricity can be structured in many ways. Practice in accounting for contracts to buy or sell non-financial items like electricity has developed over many years, and other than for PPAs, has not raised concerns among investors to other stakeholders. Therefore, in developing a timely solution, the IASB considered it an important objective to minimize the risk of unintended consequences any proposed amendments could have on how entities account for other contracts. Matthias, would you like to explain how the IASB have defined the scope of the amendments to achieve this objective?
Sure, Dennis. So stakeholders' concerns arose from contracts for renewable electricity that have particular characteristics. The IASB used these characteristics to limit the scope of contracts to which the amendments could be applied. The characteristics are a combination of the nature of the underlying source of electricity and the contractual features, specifically, for example, the pay-as-produced features. For contracts for renewable electricity to be within the scope of the proposed amendments, the contracts need to have both of the characteristics included on the slide. First, the source of electricity generation depends on uncontrollable natural conditions, for example, the weather. And second, contractual features expose the company to variability in an underlying amount of electricity. In other words, the contracts contain features which provide that the volume or timing of delivery does not align with the company's demand for electricity at that particular time. The proposed amendments will therefore apply only to these contracts and cannot be analogized to. For example, contracts for biomass energy would not meet the characteristics and would be excluded from the scope. It is also important to note that, contracts referencing nature-dependent electricity might be accounted for in accordance with IFRS accounting standards other than IFRS 9 or result in the application of other standards, for example, IFRS 10, IFRS 11, IFRS 16 leases, and IAS 28 investments in associate and or other standards.
Mm. No, thanks, Matthias. So contracts for renewable electricity are also typically accompanied by renewable energy certificates, or in short, RECs. Now, RECs are market-based instruments certifying that the bearer owns electricity produced from a renewable production facility. Therefore, RECs are an important consideration for entities when they enter into these contracts. So let's maybe address the question of whether our amendments actually deals with RECs and whether the accounting would be affected.
Well, Dennis, in short, the answer is no. The IASB concluded that it can effectively respond to stakeholders' concerns about contracts for renewable electricity separately from considering the accounting for RECs. The accounting for RECs should not be considered in isolation and would have to be looked at more broadly because there are no unique characteristics of RECs that could limit the potential consequences. Mm-hmm. This meant that if the IASB had included RECs within the project, that inclusion would have unnecessarily delayed the project because the IASB would have to consider a much broader range of arrangements. Mm-hmm. Therefore, those final amendments propose no changes to the accounting for RECs.
Mm. No, thanks, Matthias. Now, stepping to the own use requirements, an entity typically applies paragraph 2.4 of IFRS 9 to its commodity contracts that can be settled net in cash on another financial instrument. Now, if an entity holds these contracts for the purpose of the receipt of that underlying item, that contract is accounted for as a normal purchase or a normal sale. In other words, as an executory contract, until such stage as either of the parties perform. If it was not treated as a normal purchase or a sale, it would have been accounted for as a derivative. So, Matthias, could you tell us how the amendments would address stakeholders' concerns with the own use exception?
Yes. So, stakeholders have told us that the reason these contracts might fail the own use exception for the purchaser without the new amendments is because the purchaser needs to sell any electricity it cannot use very soon after delivery, say within 6 or 50 minutes. And it sells electricity to the market at the prevailing market price. Because such sales occur shortly after delivery, it calls into question whether the entity holds the contract for its own use in accordance with its expected usage requirements. Therefore, the IASB decided to amend IFRS 9 for a company to also consider the following points when assessing contracts which satisfy the scope criteria. For example, whether contractual features expose the entity to the risk that it would be obliged to buy electricity during a delivery interval in which the entity cannot use the electricity, which is the new paragraph B2.7 of IFRS 9. Mm-hmm. If the design operation of the electricity market in which the electricity is transacted under the contract requires any amounts of unused electricity to be sold within a specified time, also can be found in B2.7, and that the company has to be a net purchaser of electricity over a certain time interval. Some might think that those provisions relax the current requirements, but the ISB wanted to continue to contain all the rigor and discipline and also only apply the amendments to a special narrow set of circumstances to address stakeholders' concern.
Mm. Yeah, that's true. So an important concept, Matthias, that you just mentioned in the amendments is this net purchaser assessment. So how does that work? In principle, the ISB decided that an entity is a net purchaser if it buys enough electricity to offset the sales of any unused electricity. It would also need to do so over a reasonable period or an amount of time. This reasonable amount of time is a forward-looking as well as a backward-looking assessment, but that period of time is limited to 12 months. Now, the requirement also states that an entity is a net purchaser of electricity only if it buys sufficient electricity in the same market in which the entity originally took delivery of and then sold the electricity. The IASB considered, for example, where an entity enters a contract for nature-dependent electricity in the same market that it has a hydrogen production facility. Now, because of the variability of the electricity produced, the entity negotiated a contract for 120% of its electricity needs of the hydrogen facility. Applying the amendments, the entity is not required to make the net purchaser assessment at the level of its hydrogen facility, but at the entity level within the market in which it takes delivery of the nature-dependent electricity under the contract. Now, many contracts to buy and take delivery of nature-dependent electricity are long-dated, some up to 25 years. So to assess whether it has been and expects to be a net purchaser, the IASB did not intend to require an entity to make a detailed estimate of past, current, and expected sales and purchases of electricity over all time intervals that have been identified as a reasonable amount of time. So the IASB decided that it could reflect the assessment that needs to be made by using reasonable and supportable information.
Well, thanks, Dennis. That sort of concludes our webcast on the ONU. So let's move on to facilitate the amendments on hedge accounting. The main concern with qualifying for hedge accounting was in relation to the designation of the hedged item, being the forecast sales or purchases of electricity. This is because, unlike other hedging relationships, there's uncertainty not only due to the pricing component, but also due to the expected volume. Because no one controls when the sun shines or the wind blows, it's difficult to identify a specific volume of electricity that will consistently occur for the duration of the hedge. For the volume produced from a reference production facility, a contract for renewable electricity provides a highly affected economic hedge, no matter how variable that volume is. If no renewable electricity is produced, no settlement would be required under the contract. Therefore, the IASB permitted the designation of a variable volume of electricity to take into account the link between the contract for renewable electricity, being the hedging instrument, and the forecast sales or purchases of electricity, being the hedged item. The IASB also noted that IFRS 9 does not require the timing and amount of the cash flows under the hedged item to be perfectly aligned with the cash flows of the hedging instrument. Therefore, the IASB was of the view that if an entity were permitted to align the nominal amount of forecast transaction designated as the hedged item with the variable amount of nature-dependent electricity expected to be delivered by the facility referenced in the hedging instrument, an economic relationship could still exist. However, the IASB was clear that no change to the highly probable requirement have been made, and that the assessments of whether future electricity purchases are highly probable applies equally to forecast sales and purchases. However, if a contract referencing nature-dependent electricity requires net settlement only when an entity buys or sells electricity, any or all of the entity's forecast transactions would be covered by the contract. Therefore, the IASB clarified that if cash flows under the contract referencing nature-dependent electricity can arise only when there is a hedged sale or purchase, such forecast transactions are deemed highly probable by nature or design of the hedging relationship.
No, thanks, Matthias. I think maybe an important point to address is how the IASB's amendments might actually affect other hedging relationships not designated using the amendments.
As I noted before, stakeholders said a timely solution was needed because of an expected increase in the use of these contracts due to the increase of the demand for renewable electricity. If the IASB has expanded the scope of the proposals, it would invariably have delayed not only the publication of the initial exposure draft, but also the finalization of the project. Stakeholders will be able to comment on the need for a similar solution for other hedging relationships in the forthcoming review of the hedging accounting requirements in IFRS 9 when we start our post-implementation review on hedge accounting.
No, thanks, Matthias. So lastly, maybe moving on to some of the new disclosure requirements. So in developing the requirements or the amendments, stakeholders told the IASB that investors need additional information to really understand the effects that these contracts have on an entity's performance and cash flows, both in the current period and also in future periods. Particularly, really to understand if there has been a change in the accounting treatment due to the amendments. So therefore, the IASB is requiring additional disclosure to apply to specific populations of these contracts as illustrated on the slide. Firstly, some disclosure requirements would apply to contracts referencing nature-dependent electricity accounted for as normal purchases or sales under the own use exception. Secondly, contracts being used as hedging instruments and using the amendments to then obtain hedge accounting. And lastly, for other contracts that meet the criteria. Now, other accounting standards might require disclosures for these contracts. The IASB does not intend that entities should duplicate any of that information. That brings us to the end of this webcast. We hope this overview of the amendments has been helpful.
Thanks, Dennis. And if you have any questions or comments about the material covered, please visit our website. Thanks for your attention.